All right, we are continuing the study of Revelation. We are in chapter 11 today, Revelation for Bible Believers. And again, if you are new to these studies, we are going through this, not giving an expository study for what's exactly going to happen there doctrinally. No, we're actually going through and seeing what can we learn from this as Christians today. Because Christians are not going to go into this time period. We're going to be in heaven, like John. But let's start out here. Revelation chapter 11, verses 1 and 2. And there was given me a reed like unto a rod, and the angel stood, saying, Rise and measure the temple of God and the altar, and them that worship therein. But the court which is without the temple leave out, and measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentiles. And the holy city shall they tread under foot 42 months. Okay? Very interesting. You say, what's the significance there? What is the holy city? It's Jerusalem. But look down at verse 8 of the same chapter. And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. Wait a second. How could Jerusalem be called in the same chapter? It's called Sodom and Egypt. And yet up in verse 2, it's called the holy city. And verse 8, by the way, it's also called the great city. Great city, holy city, but it's Sodom and Egypt. What's going on there? Let me show you. Turn to Matthew chapter 5. We're going to see what Jesus thought of this city of Jerusalem. Matthew chapter 5, verse 35. Actually, we'll start in verse 34. But I say unto you, swear not at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by the earth, for it is his footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. You know what Jerusalem is? You say, what's the city of peace? Yeah, I know that. I know that. But in reality, it's the city of Jesus. According to the words of Jesus, the city of the great king. It's his city. It belongs to Jesus Christ. That's why, and you say, well, that's just there in the first century. Oh, no, no, you're quite ignorant of scripture. When Jesus Christ comes back, he rules and reigns for 1,000 years from Jerusalem. It's his city. And you say, well, it's very wicked and things like that. Yeah, Sodom and Egypt right now. Sodom and Egypt in the time of Jacob's trouble. Absolutely. If a Jew dies in their sins, they go to hell. Say God's chosen people, they go to hell. If they reject Jesus Christ, they go to hell. I have never taught that Jews are automatically saved. They're not. But they're God's chosen people. And you got to be careful messing around with the Jewish people. God has very real plans for them and for the city of Jerusalem. It's kind of funny that the Vatican right now has control of the city of Jerusalem. For all these wingnut Satanists out there that are into replacement theology, and they say the Jews run everything. Well, then why did they let the Vatican take their holiest city, the capital of Israel? Why would you give it to the Vatican? Which they did in 1993. Seems kind of strange if the Jews rule the world that they would give their holiest city to the Vatican, to non-Jews, to Gentiles. What about this thing of the Gentiles there? Turn back to Romans chapter 11. Go back to Revelation here and get the exact wording in a minute. But Romans chapter 11, verse 25. Says here, For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits. That blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. And so all Israel shall be saved, as it is written, There shall come out of Zion the Deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob, for this is my covenant unto them when I shall take away their sins. Romans 11 debunks replacement theology. God's not done with the Jews. They come back to their land in unbelief. Again, I've done whole studies on this. Proofs of scripture. You know, these idiots out there that are into replacement theology, They say, well, see, the Jews can't be God's chosen people because they don't believe in Jesus. Okay, so let me get this straight. If their system was true, the replacement theology morons out there, I'm trying to be nice here, you know. If their system was true, then the Jews would come back to Israel as saved Bible-believing Christians, and then the Lord has to pour out 7 years of his judgment, the time of Jacob's trouble, upon saved Jews. And the purpose of that would be what? No, they come back in unbelief, and the Lord confirms the New Testament by showing them a playbook, Revelation, you know. The Bible is revealed. The Lord Jesus Christ is revealed as their Messiah. You understand? Very simple. Very simple to understand. You say, why don't replacement theology people, you know, we'll just have to agree to disagree. You get that kind of thing, you know. Well, they have their beliefs, and you have your beliefs. We can all get along. Oh, no, we can't. No, we can't. This stuff is plain. It's the plain teachings of Scripture. The reason they can't see it is because they're lost. They are absolutely, completely lost. You say, well, then you're saying that you have to believe a whole bunch of things to be saved. Oh, no. You believe those things because you are saved, because you've put your faith in Jesus Christ. The reason these people don't believe them is because they haven't come to God truly repentant. So their faith in Jesus Christ is just an outward profession. You can see it's not real. Let's go back to Revelation chapter 11. We'll talk about, well, let's just go back here. We'll read the verse here and then I'll talk about this. Verse 2. For it is given unto the Gentiles, and the holy city shall they tread under foot 42 months. 3.5 years, in other words. Interesting, because Jesus Christ's ministry was 3.5 years. You're going to see this 3.5 year thing repeated quite a bit throughout the, you know, book of Revelation. 3.5 times 2 is 7. 7 is the number of completion. 7 seals, 7 trumpets, 7 vials. 7, 7, 7. 7 spirits of God. This whole thing. God has a system of numbers in the Bible. And Satan perverts it and makes numerology out of it. But you have Christians that get afraid and they say, well, I don't want to talk about the numbers and things because that's numerology. No, 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 no. God created his system of numbers in Scripture. Okay? Numerology is an occult twisting of that. But that doesn't mean that you abandon God's system of numbers in the Bible. But notice it says there, it is given unto the Gentiles, and the holy city shall they tread under foot 42 months. Very interesting. The holy city has been given to the Gentiles. They gave it to the Vatican, 1993. Why? Well, because the fullness of the Gentiles has not come in yet. You say, what's that? God is still dealing with Gentiles in different nations. But when we leave, when the rapture happens and the body of Christ leaves, you see, right now there's neither Jew nor Gentile. We're all one in Christ Jesus. So you get a Jew that's saved, they're a Christian. You get a Gentile that's saved, they're a Christian. But not so in the time of Jacob's trouble. Again, we covered that back in Revelation chapter 7. You see 144,000 Jews and then a great multitude out of every kindred, people, tongue, nation. They're separate. You see. Not so today in the church age. You got to get the distinctions in Scripture there. These wicked people that come along and they say, oh, the whole Bible teaches the same thing. They're lost. Just as simple as that. I mean, unless you're just brand new saved and you don't know any better and you're just saying a lot of dumb things, and new Christians say a lot of dumb things. I include myself in that number. Unless you're brand new saved, you know, and God will show you. Dispensationalism. He'll show you that. The right divisions of Scripture. You don't believe in that, well, you're lost. Just as simple as that. But God right now is dealing with the Gentiles. And that times those fullness of the Gentiles, when that thing comes in, it's going to be the end of the time of Jacob's trouble. We'll see that as we continue. Verses 3 through 6, let's read this. And I will give power unto my 2 witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. These are the 2 olive trees and the 2 candlesticks standing before the God of the earth. And if any man will hurt them, fire proceedeth out of their mouth, and devoureth their enemies. And if any man will hurt them, he must in this manner be killed. These have power to shut heaven, that it rain not in the days of their prophecy, and have power over waters to turn them to blood, and to smite the earth with all plagues, as often as they will. Okay, now, 1260 days. You know, you see that in verse 3 there, 1,203 score. A score is 20. So 3 score is 20 times 3, 60. So 1260 days. Now, this is interesting because today we have 365 days in our calendar. Why? Because we have a pagan calendar. Back in the Bible times, the biblical Hebrew calendar was 360 days. And now the modern day Jews have also used another pagan type of calendar. So the true biblical calendar is 360 days. 1260 is 3.5, by the way, if you calculate that out. It's 3.5 years. They're prophesying for 3.5 years. You know, and the two witnesses, again, this is not my opinion or my feelings, and we can agree to disagree. No, the two witnesses are Moses and Elijah. And I'm going to prove that to you right now. Now, the first thing that's going to come up with this, they're going to say it can't be Moses. Elijah, yes. Most people will say, yeah, Elijah. Yeah, he's one of the two witnesses. But it can't be Moses. Why? Well, because of Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. Turn there. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. And as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment. Now, see, Moses died, so he couldn't come back because that would be violating Scripture. Because, see, if it's him, if he's one of the two witnesses, you read later on in Revelation 11, which we will, you read that he is killed by the Antichrist. So, see, he died twice. So it can't be Moses. Well, you're missing something. Notice in verse 27 it says, as it is appointed unto men. Who does the appointment? God. So God is the one that sets when somebody dies. It's in his power. God can change the rules in certain special situations. I'll give you an example. Lazarus. He's dead. The Lord goes and he says, oh man, oh he's dead. Oh nuts. I don't want to contradict the thing of, you know, men are supposed to die once. I can't resurrect him from the dead because then he'll have to die again. No, Lazarus died twice. He died, Jesus resurrected him, and then he grew old and died again. All right? Yes, you can die twice if God appoints it that way. All right? So don't use Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27 to say it can't be Moses. Let me show you another very interesting thing here. Turn to Jude, the book of Jude. Right before you get to the book of Revelation, you get to the book of Jude, and then it goes to Revelation. Jude, verse 9, there's only one chapter. Check this out, this is very interesting. Yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke thee. Why did the devil want Moses' body? I mean, why on earth would the devil be so interested in the body of Moses? Well, I'm going to give you my theory on that. I wasn't there, and the Bible doesn't say crystal clear here, but I'm going to give you my theory. If the devil could have the body of Moses, then he could put Moses' body someplace and build a shrine to it, and the Jews would come to it, because the Jews, their most sacred man, I think even more so than Elijah, is Moses. They talk about the Torah, and they have Torah institutes and everything else. Who wrote the Torah? Moses. The first five books there. What the Torah is. First five books of our Bible. So if there was the body of Moses someplace, how could he be resurrected in the time of Jacob's trouble and come back to the earth and make all kinds of problems, which he's going to, him and Elijah both. You see, that's why the devil wanted the body of Moses. I firmly believe that. And if you, you know, talk to a Jew or you look into the Jewish thing and stuff, where's Moses buried at? We don't really know. Where's his body? We're not really sure. You go through the Old Testament and And they tell a lot of times they're, you know, these different people are buried, and they're setting up stone, you know, pillars and things like this and whatever else to mark their grave. There's nothing like that for Moses. Why? Because he comes back. But I'm going to show you a couple other interesting things here. Now, what you're going to be told by a lot of people who, you know, and some of them are innocent. They've just been taught. They haven't been taught the truth. I don't really hit people too hard when they say it's Enoch and Elijah are the two witnesses. That's a common teaching, and it's very false. But they'll say Enoch. Let me show you the thing, though, about Enoch as we're here in the book of Jude. Look at verse 14. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all, and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speeches, which ungodly sinners have spoken against them. Against him, excuse me. So, Enoch is back there before the flood, way back in the book of Genesis, and he is prophesying about the Lord coming back with 10,000s of his saints. Very interesting. I find that very, very kind of a unique thing there. Now let's go back to Second Kings chapter 1. What about this thing of calling fire down from heaven? You know, they open their mouth and fire comes out and devours their enemies. Go back to 2 Kings chapter 1. I'm going to say some more things about Enoch, but we'll get back to that in a minute. 2 Kings chapter 1 and verse 10. And Elijah answered and said to the captain of 50, If I be a man of God, then let fire come down from heaven and consume thee and thy 50. And there came down fire from heaven and consumed him and his 50. So, and by the way, when it says back in Revelation chapter 11 there about they open their mouth and fire comes out and things like that, they could be saying, let fire come upon thee, and the fire comes down. It doesn't mean that they're going to be like fire-breathing dragons and they're going to go like that, you know. It could just mean that when they say fire comes out of your mouth, I just said fire, see, comes out of my mouth. And the Lord brings the fire down. I think that that's what's going on there. I don't believe that they're breathing fire. All right. Maybe they could be, but, you know, that's the way I see it. But you say, what about Moses? Exodus chapter 7. So we see that Elijah definitely was able to, you know, Lord working through him, he was able to call down fire like that. But what about Moses? Exodus chapter 7, verse 19. And the Lord spake unto Moses, And the Lord spake unto Moses, Say unto Aaron, Take thy rod, and stretch out thine hand upon the waters of Egypt, and upon their streams. Okay, I messed up my reference here. Okay, I skipped that one. Okay, I'm sorry. Oh, man. I try so hard to be perfect. It just doesn't work. Numbers. It's pretty bad when you can't even follow your own notes. Oh, boy. Not very professional. Numbers. I'm skipping ahead today. I skipped three references down there. Numbers chapter 16. I apologize. I was wondering if I'm thinking, no, I'm not supposed to be there yet. Numbers chapter 16, verse 28. Okay, and Moses said, Hereby ye shall know that the Lord hath sent me to do all these works, for I have not done them of mine own mind. If these men die the common death of all men, or if they be visited after the visitation of all men, then the Lord hath sent me. But if the Lord make a new thing, and the earth open her mouth, and swallow them up with all that appertain unto them, and they go down quick into the pit, then ye shall understand that these men have provoked the Lord. Interesting, because they're seeing this thing. A lot of these sinkholes and things are opening up, and people's homes are going down, and pretty weird. You know, today, I'm saying. It's pretty wild stuff. Verse 31. And it came to pass, as he made an end of speaking all these words, that the ground clave asunder that was under them, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up, and their houses, and all the men that appertained unto Korah, and all their goods. They and all that appertained to them went down alive into the pit, and the earth closed upon them, and they perished from among the congregation. And all Israel that were round about them fled at the cry of them, for they said, lest the earth swallow us up also. And there came out a fire from the Lord and consumed the 250 men that offered incense. So Moses also spoke things, and fire came down from the Lord. So Elijah spoke, fire comes down. Moses spoke, fire comes down. Where did Enoch speak, and fire came down? He didn't. Okay, now we're going to go to 1 Kings chapter 17. Remember back in Revelation chapter 11, we read about that they're going to, you know, these two witnesses, they'll, you know, calls it not to rain, and that there's also going to be turning, they're going to be turning water into blood. 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 1. And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. So Elijah was able to make it stop raining for years. Not just a dry season, as it's been dry for a little bit and things. Years. Again, most people will not argue about the Elijah thing because, see, Elijah was not, he didn't die. He was called up to heaven. So they say, well, see, he would, you know, he wouldn't die twice and he'd come down and get killed in the, you know, there in Revelation chapter 11. Most people would not argue about that. But let's see about the thing of turning water into blood. I hope you know this story. Now we're going to turn to Exodus chapter 7, verse 19. See, if I cared about my impeccable character and things like that, I would go and edit all the other mistake out there and things. But I prefer to just let people see who I am. In fact, I do make mistakes because I don't want people worshiping me. Don't like that. You worship Jesus. Don't worship Brian Denlinger. Exodus chapter 7, verse 19. And the Lord spake unto Moses, say unto Aaron, take thy rod and stretch out thine hand upon the waters of Egypt, upon their streams, upon their rivers, and upon their ponds, and upon all their pools of water, that they may become blood, and that there may be blood throughout all the land of Egypt, both in vessels of wood and in vessels of stone. And Moses and Aaron did so. Okay, again, Moses speaks, fire comes down from heaven, just like the two witnesses do in Revelation chapter 11. Moses turns water into blood, just like the two witnesses are doing back in Revelation chapter 11. Where does Enoch do either one of those? He doesn't. You say, well, but Enoch could be there doing it for the first time. Why? What would that prove? You see, God is bringing the two witnesses, Moses and Elijah, back so that they can do these miracles on the earth so that the Jews go. That's what we read in the Old Testament. Whoa, Moses and Elijah, they're confirming it. See, the Jews require a sign, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. What about Enoch? Because there's a lot of people that are just, well, I know, brother, I mean, I know you mean well, but it's got to be Enoch. Let's look at some significant things here about Enoch. Go back to Genesis chapter 5. We'll read about him. Genesis chapter 5, beginning in verse 21. And Enoch lived 65 years and begat Methuselah. And Enoch walked with God after he begat Methuselah 300 years and begat sons and daughters. Check this out. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. He was not, and he didn't die. You read all these other people, and he died, and he died, and he died, and he died. Enoch didn't die. So what's he represent? He represents a group of people that are taken away before God's worldwide judgment comes. Christians. And isn't it interesting, I find it very interesting, that the biblical calendar is 360 days, and yet here's a man who lives 365 years. Could there be a little interesting tie in there? 365. And now today, here Christians are living in a system where we have 365 days. And you say, what about the thing of Enoch walking with God? Well, who walks more with God than Christians? I'm part of his body. You talk about walking with the Lord, you know, we're part of his body, of his flesh and of his bones. Yes, we walk with God. You can, you know, mess around with sin and things like that, but once you're saved, you're part of the body of Christ, whether you like it or not. You know, no matter how hard you try, you're not going to get out of it if you're saved. God's just going to whip you a little bit. All right? So Enoch represents a Christian taken out before worldwide judgment. He doesn't die. But what does this matter to a Jew in the time of Jacob's trouble? Because Enoch shows up, they'd be like, okay. No, it's going to be Moses. Let me show you a couple more proofs. Go back to the very end of the Old Testament. The last book, the last chapter, the book of Malachi. Malachi chapter 4, verses 4 through 6. The Old Testament ends with two people being named. Do you have any guesses who it might be? Malachi chapter 4, verse 4. Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant, which I commanded unto him in Horeb for all Israel, with the statutes and judgments. Behold, I will send you Elijah, the prophet, before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. The Old Testament ends with Moses and Elijah. And I know somebody will say, well, yeah, but the order of books are different and things for the Jews and stuff like that. Yeah, but that whole system there of the Jewish order of the books and things, I believe God has scrapped that. I believe when Moses and Elijah come back, they're going to be preaching something very similar to this book right here. The Jews reject the New Testament. Moses and Elijah are going to be preaching the New Testament. Wouldn't it be funny if they came back as King James Bible believers? You know? And we're speaking it in Hebrew and things like that, translating it in Hebrew and whatever. That'd be interesting. So you see again, Moses and Elijah. Matthew chapter 17. Matthew chapter 17, verses 1 through 3. And after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into an high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light. The appearance of Jesus Christ when he comes back at the second coming. Verse 3. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elias talking with him. Elias is your, you know, Greek coming to English. Elijah is Hebrew coming to English. That's why it's spelled that way. Okay? But Moses and Elijah connected with Christ's second coming. Just as plain as the nose on your face, brethren. Somebody says, well, we don't really know for sure. Yes, you do. All right? But you say, I don't understand, Brother Brian. I thought you said that your study of Revelation was an expository study for Bible-believing Christians. You know, instruction in righteousness. How does this whole thing of the two witnesses, I mean, you're talking about this being for the Jews. You're getting into the doctrines there and things like this. That's my point. The instruction in righteousness there, you can turn back to Revelation chapter 11. The instruction in righteousness that we're learning from this chapter and from the study of who the two witnesses are is the fact that the two witnesses are coming back for the Jews to confirm the word to the Jews, not the body of Christ. I mean, what would you think if Moses and Elijah showed up and they're coming around there saying, I want to testify to you that Jesus Christ is your Messiah and thing. Christians would be like, okay, Lord, it's nice to see Moses and Elijah, on media or something, television, internet, whatever else. It's nice to see that they're doing all this stuff, but I do believe in you. I do trust in you. I don't need to see these two guys. But to the Jews, different story, completely different story. They need to see the signs and wonders. And who better than to come back than Moses, the law, Elijah, the prophets. They're not going to be able to just look at those two guys and say, yeah, sure, And it isn't just enough that they come back and say, hey, I'm Moses, this is Elijah, we got some things to talk to you Jews about. The Jews would probably be like, huh? Oh, I know you don't believe us, so watch this. And they perform the miracles and say, see, same thing that we did in the Old Testament. Pretty incredible. So the instruction in righteousness is there, Christian. This is another proof that the fact that the Christians are gone before this time comes. We're not in there. It's the time of Jacob's trouble, Israel's trouble. Verse 7, Revelation chapter 11, verse 7. Let's continue. And when they shall have finished their testimony, the beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them and shall overcome them and kill them. Okay? Notice there, the beginning, when they shall have finished their testimony. Turn to John chapter 7. Some very comforting thoughts here with these scriptures coming up. John chapter 7 and verse 30. John chapter 7 verse 30. Then they sought to take him, but no man laid hands on him, because his hour was not yet come. Speaking of the Lord Jesus. Right? John chapter 8 verse 20. These words spake Jesus in the treasury, as he taught in the temple, and no man laid hands on him, for his hour was not yet come. Get back to this in just a minute. Acts chapter 12. The Lord had a specific reason. He came here to the earth to die on the cross. All right. Present himself to the Jews, and they would reject him, and he died on the cross. And there was a specific time that the Lord had that thing worked out. 3.5 years. Time of Jacob's trouble. Moses and Elijah, 3.5 years. Moses and Elijah meeting with Jesus. Mount of Transfiguration. All kinds of works itself out, Acts chapter 12, verse 11. And when Peter was come to himself, he said, Now I know of a surety that the Lord hath sent his angel and hath delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Jews. You see, what point are you trying to make here? The point I'm trying to make is, brethren, the two witnesses, the Bible says that they're going to be prophesying for 1,260 days. And when they finish their testimony, the Lord gives the Antichrist power to kill them. You can learn something very instructive there. Your death, your life, and your death, if you die before the catching away of the body, bride of Christ, it's all planned out by the Lord. There's never going to come a point in time where all of a sudden you're going someplace and there's a gunshot and you fall over dead and the Lord goes, oh, I took my eyes off of him for just a minute. The devil got him. Oh, nuts. No, you're in his hand. What on earth are you worried about people out there doing bad things to you? God has it all timed out. He has your whole life planned out. Well, I better not witness. I better not take strong stance because I could get killed. You're not going to get killed until the Lord says, okay. Until your testimony is finished, until your work for the Lord is done. Now, you can speed up the process if you live in sin, if you live wickedly. Absolutely. But you're doing right and living for the Lord and things, the Lord's using you. Don't worry about death. He's got it planned. Okay? 2 Timothy chapter 3. It's a great comfort to know that, you know, the Lord, I mean, you're basically invincible until the Lord says, okay, your testimony's done, right? The enemy can't kill you. The enemy can't hurt you unless God gives them permission. And they're constantly trying to drum up all this, you know. I remember this one time I was at this farm and there was this big, you know, turkey, big Tom, you know, they call him. And he was like puffing himself up and he's scraping his wings on the ground, you know, like, stay away from my, you know, turkey wife, you know, and things and stuff. And he's like, you know, trying to scare me. And I'm just like, stupid turkey, I could like kick you across the field here, you know. I mean, see, that's what the devil and his people do. And I talk about the Jesuits, I talk about these evil people and things. And yeah, it could be really bad if they get, you know, when they get in power and stuff. But the fact of the matter is, they're like that turkey. They puff themselves up. We control the New World Order. We have concentration camps. We have internment camps. We have torture techniques. We have this. You should be afraid of us, Christians. They're just turkeys puffing themselves up. Don't worry about them. Lord will protect you. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 10 through 12. But thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. I can tell you right now, there have been situations I've gotten myself into and the Lord's allowed me to go through that I'm just like, this is not good. I mean, this is just like, this is the end. I'm not going to get out of this. And Lord gets me through it. You know, I've seen that thing happen time and time again. Why? Because the Lord has my life planned out. When you're saved, and if you're lost, by the way, let me just say this. You don't have that protection. There's nothing there that, there's no reason why God's going to hold you in his hand and say, I'll protect you. No. You need to get saved. And when you get saved, God will have a purpose for your life. He'll have a plan for your life. He'll protect you. You know, you get somebody that's into this mind control thing, MKUltra, whatever else, and you're, you know, being forced to do things against your will and stuff, like a lot of the Hollywood celebrities and other people and things like this. You know, so what should we do? How do I get out? How do I deprogram? Get saved. Put your life in the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ, and he'll protect you. You say, but I could get in trouble. I have a contract, and I have this, and he'll get you through it. He'll get you through it. Well, if I get out of that stuff, then I could get saved. No. You get saved, and the Lord will get you out of it. All right? 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. One of the crowns of reward there, the crown of righteousness, comes to you if you're actually loving the appearing of Jesus Christ. You want to see Jesus Christ. You say, but I don't know, brother, I'm really starting to, things are getting bad. I mean, we're about ready to go into World War III, and I don't know if we're going to make it, and I'm starting to lose my faith. Okay, you're not going to get a crown of righteousness. Oh, maybe Jesus isn't coming back. Okay, you're going to lose your crown. Okay? Look forward to Jesus Christ coming. And, you know, I look at this verse and I say, okay, you know, yeah, I've fought a good fight, but I have not, I don't really feel that I've finished my course yet. I can't really say that, you know, I feel like I've done everything the Lord wanted me to do. You know, I see there's so much more work to do for the Lord. But, you know, that's up to the Lord to decide when he's going to be catching us out of here. I don't really know when it's going to be. But the time that I have, I'm going to understand that the Lord's going to preserve my life. I've got a lot of people and they say, boy, if you were in my country, you'd be in prison for preaching the way that you preach. Well, if the Lord would allow it, yeah. And it's funny because back in the book of Acts, they are going to prison and the Lord's busting them out of prison and saying, go back and preach. You know? Don't worry about it. In other words, jump down to verse 16 there in 2 Timothy chapter 4. At my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known and that all the Gentiles might hear. And I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. And the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. It's encouraging, isn't it? Go back to Revelation chapter 11. When they shall have finished their testimony. God's not going to allow anything bad to happen to you, brethren, until you're finished with your testimony down here. Until you have finished the race that's set before you. And honestly, I think most of us are going to get raptured. Yeah, it could get bad. Yeah, we could get killed. You could find out in the news someday that I got executed or something like that. But it's only going to be if the Lord allows it. So when you have that understanding, when you have this knowledge that God plans out your life and that you're in the palm of his hand and nobody can pluck you, no man can pluck you out of his hand, when you understand that, now it removes fear. You don't have to think, what are we going to do? The Illuminati's taking over and... Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Daniel did great things under the very first New World Order. And Nebuchadnezzar is far more powerful and far more evil than anybody on earth today, including the Black Pope. All right? He's probably the most powerful man on the earth right now, the Black Pope, telling the White Pope what to do, although they're both Jesuits now, which is kind of a weird setup. But Nebuchadnezzar was far more powerful than both those men combined. All right? And yet Daniel was able to do great things, not only under him, but under the kings that followed. Pretty interesting. But let's continue. Verse 8. And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. All right? Let me put this thing here so I'm not getting confused. You know, find that very interesting, you know, that these two witnesses, Moses and Elijah, are killed and the dead bodies drop down the streets right there. See what happens. Verse 9 and 10. And they of the people and kindreds and tongues and nations shall see their dead bodies 3 days and in half, and shall not suffer their dead bodies to be put in graves. Wait a second. You mean what it meant there is the Jews that are living in the general vicinity are going to see their dead bodies. Because, see, this was written back by, you know, Bronze Age shepherds or something like this, I'll hear atheists say, or whatever else. And they couldn't possibly see into the future and things because that would prove the Bible to be true, give it a more sure word of prophecy, you know. How are these... primitive people of the past able to give a prophecy that one day two men would be killed in the streets of Jerusalem and the whole world, not just the Jews. Notice it says, they of the people and kindreds and tongues and nations shall see their dead bodies. Nations. All people are going to see the dead bodies for 3 days, 3.5 days. You can't get all people in the world to travel over there to Jerusalem in 3.5 days. Not possible. Nor would people do that. You see what's going on there? Well, you can see live satellite streaming television of anything going on in the world at any time now. Prophecy. Confirm scripture. But look at the reaction of the people. Verse 10. And they that dwell upon the earth shall rejoice over them and make merry and shall send gifts one to another because these two prophets tormented them that dwelt on the earth. That's pretty sick. Two men of God and the Antichrist kills them and people are looking and checking out these dead bodies and going, let's get back on there. Let's see the live streaming thing. Oh, they're still there. Oh, this is great. Let's send gifts to each other. You know, I used to read that stuff years and years ago and think, man, I can't imagine things getting that sick. Well, I can imagine it now. I can imagine it now, definitely. Any kind of a move towards righteousness or any kind of a thing, you know, I got to speak here for a minute, you know, on this whole thing of this Trump issue, this Donald Trump thing. I mean, the guy is Jesuit educated. There's all kinds of problems with the guy. But, you know, he comes out with some moral types of things and these liberal, insane, lunatic people are just like railing and just, you know, and stuff like this. We can't go back, you know, and he's going to do all this conservative stuff. These people are sick. They're absolutely sick, you know. And you look at this and you go, these people are going to go into the time of Jacob's trouble and you're going to get these two guys being judgmental, Moses and Elijah, and they're coming and they're not just preaching against sin and wickedness. They're actually bringing curses upon the earth and doing bad things to people, you know, that have rejected the Lord. When they die, I could see these people definitely cheering and being happy to see these dead bodies. But look what happens in verse 11 here. And after 3 days and a half, there's that three and a half again, the spirit of life from God entered into them, and they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell upon them which saw them. Again, the live streaming thing. You know, you're going to have people looking, and they're watching, and all of a sudden, breaking news, these two men that were making such trouble and things like this, these two ultimate terrorists or whatever they're going to call them, they just got up. And they stand up. I know Ruckman, you know, he drew a thing in his Revelation study right there, Ruckman's Apocalypse. And he has it, you know, the people are being beheaded in this time of Jacob's trouble. You read about that in Revelation chapter 6. You know, they're being beheaded for the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. And he said, you know, it'd be kind of interesting if the Antichrist beheads Moses and Elijah and then just throws the bodies out into the streets or just beheads them right there, you know, whatever. And you got the head laying over here and the body laying over here and there's all this blood, you know, and everything else. And it's all dried and whatever else. And the bodies are laying there for 3.5 days. And all of a sudden, 3.5 days, here comes the head, you know, back onto the body. They stand up. Yeah, that could cause a great fear. Just a little bit. That'd be kind of weird. Look at what happens in verse 12. And they heard a great voice from heaven saying unto them, come up hither. And they ascended up to heaven in a cloud, and their enemies beheld them. Okay? You get, again, you get, there's so many groups of heretics out there. Good night. And then you get these people and they say, there are no raptures in the Bible. There's not one place. And, you know, and then they'll try to get you with the thing, the word rapture's not there. Yes, we know. But what happens? The catching away there, it's a rapturous thing. It makes rapture being joy. Okay? All right? Yes, I know the word rapture's not in there, but what it's defining is, you know. And but you get people, you know, no one ever goes up to heaven. You know, I've heard this, you know, from people. Nobody ever goes up to heaven. They all stay on the earth. Okay? What do you do with verse 12? You know, people are crazy. Verse 13. In the same hour was there a great earthquake, and the tenth part of the city fell, and in the earthquake were slain of men 7,000, and the remnant were affrighted and gave glory to the God of heaven. So this city, OK, Okay, 10th part of the city fell. What are we talking about? Jerusalem. And isn't it interesting that in that earthquake, how many people die? 7,000. Seven, again. 3.5 days. 3.5 is half of 7. God has the whole thing worked out. Okay? But notice there, it says that the remnant were affrighted, people in Jerusalem, and gave glory to the God of heaven. So these lost Jews that are in this time of Jacob's trouble, this thing happens in their city, and they're being wicked and things like that, and yet they'll give glory to the God of heaven after this earthquake happens. The people give glory to the God of heaven. Compare that to what happens in Revelation chapter 18. You can turn back to Revelation 18, verse 15 through 21. This is the destruction of the Vatican, Rome, Mystery Babylon. Look what happens here, Revelation chapter 18, verse 15. The merchants of these things which were made rich by her shall stand afar off for the fear of her torment, weeping and wailing, and saying, "Alas, alas, that great city that was clothed in fine linen and purple and scarlet and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls." Interesting, too, I've made this point in other studies. This Mystery Babylon, she doesn't have silver, just gold and precious stones. Why? Because silver in your King James Bible is a reference to Scripture. The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified 7 times. Psalm, 12, 6 through 7, I think it is. Very interesting. So the Vatican does not have silver. They're not concerned with silver, just gold and precious stones. But let's continue. Verse 17. For in 1 hour so great riches has come to naught, and every shipmaster and all the company in ships and sailors and as many as trade by sea stood afar off and cried when they saw the smoke of her burning, saying, "What city is like unto this great city?" And they cast dust on their heads and cried, weeping and wailing, saying, "Alas, alas, that great city, wherein were made rich all that had ships in the sea by reason of her costliness, for in 1 hour is she made desolate. Rejoice over her, thou heaven, and ye holy apostles and prophets, for God hath avenged you on her." And a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone and cast it into the sea, saying, "Thus with violence shall that great city, Babylon, be thrown down and shall be found no more at all." Now you compare that with what goes on in Revelation chapter 11. The city there, Jerusalem, when it falls, or when they have this earthquake, this great earthquake, the people are there, they're giving glory to God. They're Jews that are there. Okay? But when you have the Vatican, Mystery Babylon there, the city that reigns over the kings of the earth, when that falls, everybody's standing around going, oh, I'm losing all this money. Oh, all that money that was there. Why? Because the Vatican owns the banking system. I think the oldest bank in the world was actually a Catholic bank. You can look that up. The Bank of Saint somebody, whatever the guy's name was. Did a study on that years ago. But let's continue here. Revelation chapter 11, verses 14 through 17. The second woe is past, and behold, the third woe cometh quickly. And the seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven, saying, "The kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever." And the four and twenty elders, which sat before God on their seats, fell upon their faces and worshipped God, saying, "We give thee thanks, O Lord God Almighty, which art and wast and art to come, because thou hast taken to thee thy great power and hast reigned." Go back in your Bible to Jeremiah chapter 30. Jeremiah 30, verses 10 and 11. Actually, we'll go up to verse 7. "Alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it." Israel. God's not going to totally wipe him out. "For it shall come to pass in that day, saith the Lord of hosts, that I will break his yoke from off thy neck and will burst thy bonds, and strangers shall no more serve themselves of him. And they shall serve the Lord their God and David their king, whom I will raise up unto them. Jesus Christ is called the Son of David many times. David was a type of Christ. A lot of the prophecies that Jesus Christ fulfilled when he came to the earth, David wrote them almost like about himself in the book of Psalms. Very interesting. But look at verse 10. Therefore fear thou not, O my servant Jacob, saith the Lord, neither be dismayed, O Israel. For lo, I will save thee from afar, and thy seed from the land of their captivity, and Jacob shall return, and shall be in rest, and be quiet, and none shall make him afraid. Millennial kingdom, in other words. For I am with thee, saith the Lord, to save thee, though I make a full end of all nations, whither I have scattered thee, yet will I not make a full end of thee. But I will correct thee in measure, and will not leave thee altogether unpunished. Very true for today. You know, I was talking about earlier about the testimony that the two witnesses have, and you don't have to worry about being taken out before that thing happens. Right now, just the other day, the ISIS was firing rockets at Israel from Egypt, you know, and their missile defense system and things in Israel, they shot these missiles down and stuff, and, you know, and the Jews are like surrounded by all these, you know, Islamic, you know, satanic enemies and things, and they're all doing, you know, we're going to destroy Israel and stuff. Don't worry about it. You know, I mean, I saw some Islamic wingnut the one time, and he's like yelling, you know, he's at this rally, and he's out there, and he's yelling, he's like, we will destroy the Jews, you know, and it's like, no, you will not. I don't think so. The Lord's going to make a full end of all nations. Why? So that he can rule them. So he comes back and he rules and reigns from Jerusalem, his city, the city of the great king. I don't know, Brother Brian, it's looking pretty bad for the Jews over there in Israel. I think that they're going to get wiped out. I think it's, yeah, well then you don't read the Bible. I read the Bible, I believe the Bible. And my King James Bible says that God has plans for those Jews in Israel right now. It's a geographic prophecy too, by the way. Notice that. All these horrible, stupid people out there. You know, we're the true Jews, man. We're the Jews. Are you in Israel? Well, no. But, okay, get over to Israel. Why? Because the land is connected with the people. All those people over there, they're white people. They're Ashkenazi Jews and stuff. And by the way, let me just say this. An Ashkenazi Jew means a Jew that lived in Germany. Okay? I'm a German-American. Oh, then because you say American, then you must be a Native American. No, I'm German ancestry living in America. An Ashkenazi Jew is somebody who is a Jew that lived in the land of Ashkenaz. Oh, they're not the real Jews, though. I don't agree with that. They're fake Jews over there in Israel. They're not the real Jews. Then why are prophecies being fulfilled surrounding those people that are over there? Some people just don't get it. Verse 18, Revelation 11, verse 18. And the nations were angry, and thy wrath is come, and the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and that thou shouldest give reward unto thy servants the prophets, and to the saints, and them that fear thy name, small and great, and shouldest destroy them which destroy the earth. Good verse there. You know, and I don't go off on this a whole lot, but you know, I think Christians have a responsibility to cherish and love what God created, nature. And, you know, you don't worship it. You don't say, well, you know, I just, you know, become an environmental preservationist. People shouldn't have access to certain areas and things. That's stupid. That's not what God designed. You know, we need to be able to go out and take care of what God provided on this planet. And, you know, you have all the wicked, greedy people out there with, you know, the gas and oil companies and things like this, just destroying the environment and geoengineering. And I mean, all sorts of things. They're destroying the earth. You know, I mean, I saw this thing yesterday where there was a robot that they sent into the one Fukushima, you know, the Daiichi or whatever plant thing there back in 2011, got hit with the tsunami, the nuclear plant melted down and stuff. And it's like, oh, you don't worry about it. It's fine. We're pumping all this water into it from the sea and then pumping the radioactive water out into the ocean. It's safe there. Don't worry about it. Because we're scientists, we got it figured out. And they sent this robot in, with a little camera on it to fix the one radio, the one reactor thing. I just like 2 days ago. And it was so, the radiation levels were so high, it was causing the robot to malfunction, and they had to get the robot out of there. And I'm like, and they said the radiation levels are so high in this one reactor that literally, if a person walked in there, it would kill them instantly. Just bam, dead. What are they doing? They're destroying the Earth. That radiation that's coming out of Fukushima and things like this. And I saw videos of people driving over there shortly after it happened, and it's like they're miles away from the nuclear plant, and they're like reading with their Geiger counters, and it's like, pegged and stuff. But the news media is like, don't worry, it's safe, it's safe. Don't worry about it. The oceans, there's huge islands of plastic debris and stuff like this. Again, back when I was building boats, we put plaques on our boats, the Coast Guard, what you can dump. And it was like 5 miles out, you could pretty much dump anything overboard in the ocean. And I remember putting the plate on going, you can dump any kind of garbage 5 miles out at sea. Basically, I forget the exact numbers, but it was crazy. I'm just going, huh? Are you kidding me? What's happening? People are destroying the earth. Sure. And the Lord has a controversy with that. See, it's God's planet. This planet belongs to Him. And we're supposed to take care of what He's created. Kind of like your body. Your body belongs to the Lord. The Bible says the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Everything on earth belongs to God. But you take people and they take their bodies and they scratch it, put ink in it. Oh, they don't do that. That'd be too primitive. No, they use a little electric thing. And it cuts into you and stuff like that. Puts ink into it. Tattoos. And I know there are saved people that have tattoos. I understand it. I'm not saying you're lost if you have a tattoo. People get tattoos before they get saved and things. But I'm kicking this thing because you see these modern Christians and they say, I have tattoos. I got tattoos so I can witness to people. No, I don't think so. But people do all kinds of piercings and do all kinds of weird stuff to their bodies. That's God's property. And all the wickedness that goes on with the earth and stuff, God's going to take care of it. Yeah, I got to tell you another little story here. If you haven't seen this, I just thought this was very humorous. Bees down in Florida, especially, they're just dropping like crazy, these honeybees and things, wild bees. And because they're like spraying everything down there to kill mosquitoes, because of the Zika virus, which is a whole other big scam, but won't get into that right now. But they're spraying everything down there, and it's just decimating the bees. And I saw that there was this report, and they said that scientists are developing, they're going to develop drones, little drones that can fly around and pollinate flowers. Oh, these people. I mean, it's not even just ridiculous. It's just like these people are mentally retarded. I mean, there's nothing else I can say. These scientists, GPS and artificial intelligence will replace the bees, Like that would work. They're insane. But let's finish up here. Revelation chapter 11, verse 19. And the temple of God was opened in heaven. And there was seen in his temple the ark of his testament, and there were lightnings and voices and thunderings and an earthquake and great hail. Well, go to Job chapter 38. What can we learn from the last verse there of Revelation chapter 11? Well, if you read your Bible, you're going to see that many times when great men get in the presence of the Lord, in the presence of an angel, even, they're falling down on the ground and they're scared to death. I'm going to show you, if you want a little bit of a pre-experience of God's power. Job chapter 38, verses 1 through 4. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, Who is this that darkeneth counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up now thy loins like a man, for I will demand of thee, and answer thou me. Where wast thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? Declare if thou hast understanding. What did we just read? God spoke to Job out of a tornado, a whirlwind. Okay? You want to have a little experience, a little pre-experience, so to speak, of what it's like to be in the presence of Almighty God. Next time there's a really, really, really violent thunderstorm, or an earthquake too. There's a really, really violent thunderstorm, lots of lightning and thunder just hitting everywhere. Walk outside, just stand there in the presence of all that. And see how good you do with your courage. Okay? And then you understand a little bit why these guys, when they hear God speaking to them, they're going, whoa, and they're falling down there and they're scared to death. It's not that they're primitive people or anything else. It's because in the presence of God, there's power there. Power like you can't imagine. You know, I've never seen a tornado happen up close, but I've seen plenty of videos. I mean, they're hitting all over the place down in the southern states and things. I mean, a couple weeks ago, it was like, I think it was 44, 45 or something, tornadoes hit in one day. You know, scary stuff. But I've been outside different times. I remember this one time I was fishing, you know, at the Talpahawken River. I know some of you are from Berks County, down there in Pennsylvania. You know what I mean by Talpahawken River. It's there near Reading, and then it goes down through and stuff. But we were there, my brother-in-law and I, and I remember this, it was like we're fishing, you know, we're like fishing fanatics, you know, we'd fish year-round. And we're standing in the river, you know, we got waders on and fishing rods and stuff. And it's like, you know, you could hear the thunder coming in the distance. It's like, we're still good. We're still fishing. Let's stand in the water with fishing poles, you know, and let's, you know, fish while there's lightning coming. That's brilliant. But, you know, we're very dedicated. And I remember we're like standing there and, you know, it's like, looking back, it's like, man, the sky's getting really dark, but the fishing is really good. So we're like fishing and stuff, you know. And it's, you know, it's starting to get really bad. And it was like, you know, we look at each other and it's like, probably should get going here. Yeah, I think so. You know, so we're like getting in, you know, get everything secured. And we're like, you know, get out to the trail. There's a walking trail beside a lot of the Talpahawken River. So we get out to the trail and we're starting to walk. And all of a sudden it was just like the heavens just opened up and, you know, just rain. And it's just lightning hitting everywhere. And we're going from a walk to now we're running full tilt to get back to the truck, you know, and we're running down this jogging path, and we get down there, and there's this bridge that you have to cross, that crosses the river, because the trail, the parking lot's like here, you go down and across the bridge, and then the trail's here, that goes up along the river. We got to cross this bridge. Problem is, the bridge is a metal grate bridge. So we're soaking wet, we got fishing rods, which are a nice conductor for electricity, being fiberglass, you know. And, you know, we got to run, we're, you know, across a metal bridge. And, you know, lightning is just like, boom, and it's like thunder, and it's just like, I mean, it's shaking your insides. I mean, it's what you call a scary experience. Obviously, we got across and everything, the Lord spared us, but, you know, I've been in a few really bad thunderstorms outside, and I can tell you, it is a scary thing, you know. And don't tell me that anybody can stand up to that stuff and just stand out there proudly and just, you know, not when thunder's hitting, and especially not if some whirlwind, some tornado comes and you hear a voice coming out of it. I don't think so. You need to have a proper respect and fear of the Lord and of His power. Okay? So, just another neat chapter, some really neat things there the Lord showed me, and I hope it's been an encouragement to you. That we don't have to worry about things that are coming. I mean, you know, if the Lord delivers us out of evil things today, why on earth would He put us through the time of Jacob's trouble? It doesn't make any sense. Now He's going to be taking us out beforehand. Then He's going to start to deal with the Jews again. And the Bible says that we are to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. I have that on my old pickup truck. And God will prosper your life. I'm not preaching prosperity gospel, so don't get excited. But, you know, God will do things for you when you stand up for that nation of Israel. And I'm going to stand up for them. And I don't care what people say. So, that's going to be it for this study. Got a lot of things going, so I'm going to end the video. But I just wanted to thank everybody out there for your prayers. Of course, always for the donations. That keeps us going. Thank you. going to be bringing out some information here soon. I'm still kind of in the research phase of this right now, but I've changed our sleeping patterns, and I've been struggling with this thing now for a couple of years, the thing of sleeping. And I think the Lord's finally really, you know, I mean, I understand it's never going to be perfect, you know, sleeping patterns and stuff. As a Christian, you're going to get attacked spiritually and things, and you're going to have whatever. But, you know, it's a good system. It's actually 6:51 right now as I'm finishing this. I've been preaching. I've been up since about 4 o'clock this morning, and I feel great. There's a pretty neat tactic, but I'm going to let it go for a little while to just say, okay, you know, I've been doing this for a month or two. So we'll talk more about the sleep thing in the future here. But I guess that's going to be it. We'll see you in the next study. Thank you very much for watching.